Chulin, page 33, we are six lines from the top of the page. People spend a lot of energy and time and money in order to be healthy. One of the ideas is eating meat. But what is the proper way to eat meat? Those who believe in the value of protein and more. We go back so many years, approximately 1700 years ago. Our rabbis, based on our Torah, they give us very clear instructions. One of them is the health way. Today, in our daf, we have a clear instruction of eating meat properly. Just an example is to make sure that there's no blood within the meat. It's out. And then in a framework of time, between they kosher the meat and eating it and more. So let's start with the first part of our discussion, which, as we said, six lines from the top of the page. Amar Rav Acha bar Yaakov, Shma mina mid Rabbi Shimon ben Lakish, Mezamnim Yisrael al bnei me'ai, ve'ein mezamnim ovdei kochavim al bnei me'ai. So here we talk about the part of the animal, which is the internal organs. And the key is that we explained yesterday and day before yesterday, when it's come to two simanim, two important components in the law of kosher slaughtering, kosher shechita of animals, which is the windpipe and the esophagus. And with this animal, unlike bird that needs only one, animals need these two to be proper. So the moment that the windpipe is cut, it's like the lung was taken from the body of the animal, and we explained yesterday, it's like being in the basket. So therefore, we can ask a fellow Israel, a fellow Jew, to partake of the slaughter of animal internal part. You do not do that with someone who idol worshiper. And Imrei Binah, Tiferet Yaakov, and other Mefarshim expand on that. Why? But here in the Sugiyah itself, they explain, Maitama, why you differentiate? Yisrael de Bishchita Talya Milta. Our fellow Jew, his Jewish law requirement, his right to eat a kosher animal, depends on the process of slaughtering. So once there is a proper severing of the animal's pipe, so therefore the internal organs are permitted to be eaten. That's what we explained yesterday, based on the Dvarim, chapter 12. They said, Vezavachta ve'achalta. And the Beit Meir explained, the moment you do the proper slaughter, so then you can eat it. There is a very extensive write-up in my brother-in-law book, Daf al Daf, and Rav Mandelbaum, he brought several sources to that. One is the famous Mizrahi. The Rav Mizrahi on Parashat Vayeshev explained the famous disputation, if you say, between Yosef, our forefather Joseph, and the other brothers. It's the Yosef hold that Behema Mefarkeset, since it's not total final stage of death, is prohibited as one of the Noahide laws, which is eating part of the animal when they are still alive. It's called Ever Minachai. Versus the other brothers hold that it's okay to eat it. And that's the difference here between a idol worshiper and a fellow Jew. Chatam Sofer challenged that, how you dealing with Ever Minachai while there are some issues, especially in those days in Europe, with blood in the eggs and more. And my brother-in-law, Rav Mandelbaum, expanded tremendously. He brought a lot of responsa, Chatam Sofer, Tvuot Shor, and many more, and you're welcome to read more. But anyway, the Gemara said, Kevan de'ika shchita me'aliyata, ishterilu, ovdei kochavim devin chira sageilehu. Those idol worshippers that they killing animal is allowed, obviously they are under the seven Noahide laws, which is the issue of ever minachai, as we explained. But they permitted to eat animal by mere piercing, and so that matter of permitting consumption depends on the animal actual death. So in a sense, it's the same analogous, the same one as they taking a limb from a living animal, which is the forbidden. So it's the same as you cut part of the animal before they die. So they prohibited even after the animal is already no longer among the living. And obviously, there's a way more to discuss. There is a well-known Rashi in Sanhedrin 59 that expand on that. And as we said, Chatam Sofer have a lot of write-up on this. So Amar Rav Papa, Hava Yativna, Kamei de Rav Acha Bar Yaakov, Uvae de Emale, Mi'i Kamidi Leisrael Sharu Leoved Kochovim Asur. So I am basically about to discuss it with the great scholar of Acha Bar Yaakov. Why you differentiate here? Why it's a certain thing forbidden to those idol worshippers versus here? Velo amrinan lein, I didn't say it to him, de amina hatama kamar, because he explained his view. Because you can have something that allowed to us and prohibited to idol worshipper. It's Ora Yashar explained that you need to have something that carries a lot of weight to go in that direction. Tanya Deloki Rav Acha Bar Yaakov. So the question is, why you don't use the term Tiuvta? So is a response called Oneg Yom Tov that expand why they use the word Tanya. But anyway, ha'rotze le'chol mi'be'ema kodem she'teitze nafsha. If one wishes to eat meat taken from an animal prior to its final death, and Rashi said that as far as the quality of the meat is considering higher, chotech kezait basar mi'beit ha'shchita u'molcho yafe yafe. So he should cut a smaller olive bark of meat from the place of the slaughter, and he sold it very well, and he washed it very well, and then he should umamtin la ad sheteitze nafsha. He should wait until the animal has a final death. That's a well-known Gemara in Sanhedrin 63. That the Torah prohibited the negative commandment, lo tochlu al adam, that you should not eat before the animal is total dead. Ve'ochlo, echad goved kochavim, ve'echad Yisrael mutarim bo, both idol worshipper or a fellow Jew are permitted to eat this meat. So that's basically contradicted what Rav Acha Bar Yaakov teaching, that a idol worshipper permitting consumption does not depend on the animal's actually dying, and so by meat removed from a steel threshing animal is not analogous to the limb taken from a living animal. Mesayel Rav Idi Baravin, Amar Rav Idi Baravin, Amar Rav Yitzchak Bar Ashi'an, Harotze Sheyavri, Yavri, so it's advised for a good health, Chotech Kezait בשר מבית שחידתה של בהמה, ומולכו יפה יפה, ומדיחו יפה יפה, וממתין לה עד שתצא נפשה, אחד עובד כוכבים ואחד ישראל מותרים בו. That's the פנים יפות in פרשת ראה, so one of the commentator, he said that that's the meaning of the pasuk, רק חזק לבלתי יכול אדם. That the meaning is that you wait, but you do all the process, which is full slaughter, washing and waiting until the animal dies, and then you may eat it. Before we go to the following Mishnah, some words of introduction. We're going to deal with the law of ritual impurity. And the highest level of ritual impurity, we call it like grandpa, avi avot atuma, the highest level, is contacting with a dead body. And the process the Torah describes at length, both in Book of Bamidbar, chapter 19, and other places. That's avi avot atuma. The next stage is someone, a person or vessel that become ritually impure by touching the avi avot hatumah, and or if you have one of the eight creeping animals that Torah described in the book of Vayikra chapter 11, the carcass, the dead body of domesticated animal or not domesticated animal, and many more, as the Mishnah in Kelim chapter 1 speaks about zav, zava, a Nida, leper, it's a different variation. And then we have Vlad. Vlad is someone who can be like Rishon and Sheni and Shlishi, touch Avatuma. Now, it's important to note that anything that has a potential to be pure is something that can be dark in the mikveh, in the ritual bath, versus things that you cannot, then is purification is cannot take place. Now, obviously, before we go to all the stages, we here zoom on one phase of that, which is the contamination of meat by a ritual impurity. The before food can become a ritually impure, it has to be susceptible to ritual impurity, and that applied to stage of being wet. And there is another abbreviation we need to remember. In Hebrew we said Yad Shachat Dam. It's an acronym, it's an abbreviation of Yad, which is the seventh form of liquid part that make it wet if it's attached to. Yud is Yain, Dalet is Dvash, meaning honey, beet or honey. And then Shin is olive oil, shemen. Chet is rev. Tet is tal, like dew. Dalet is blood, dam. And mem is mayim. So these yad shachat dam, they it's part of our sugya. We're dealing with any type of meat that become ritually impure by becoming wet, and here we focus on either water or blood. That's based on what the Torah tells us in Leviticus chapter 11, verse 34. Mikol ha'ochel asher yachel, asher yavo alav mayim yitma, anything that eaten that's connected to water, v'chol mashke asher yishate b'chol kli yitma. So that's the rabbinic enactment based on that, that it has to be connected to that. The Torah repeated more than once. So, Hashochet behema, chaya ve'of, ve'lo yatsa me'emda. Usually, in our mindset, when someone slaughter any form of animal, domesticated animal, can be a not domesticated animal, can be a bird, etc. They have to be blood coming out. But here is a situation that the blood somehow not come out. So they said ksherim, they are kosher, because the whole heiter achila, the whole notion of allowing a person to consume that meat, it's not depend upon the blood coming out, only by shchitat simanim, by cutting the, when it's animal, it has to be two, the windpipe and esophagus. If it's bird, it has to be at least, it has to be one, right? Either one. Ve'ne'echalin b'yadai mesoavot, and they may be eaten with unclean, which is unwashed hands, which means that carries, stam yadayim, that carries ritual purity of netilat yadayim, of washing hands, that Rambam said in a Pirusha Mishnayot, he says that any type of gzerat chachamim, the rabbinic enactment over netilat yadayim. So, lefi shelo hukhsheru bedam. The reason it's because they were not made susceptible to ritual impurity by becoming wet with blood, and therefore will not become ritual impurity through contact with unclean hand. The whole degree, the whole ruling of King Solomon and his Bet Din of Shniyot, that's applied to Kodashim. So therefore, if you touch hand Kodashim, they become Shlishi Letumah Midrabanan. And if that Kodashim touch another consecrated one, it becomes Revi'i Letumah. Later, the sages expand it, make it Shlishi Letumah. Now, one of the reasons you see, for example, the Ben Ish Chai, Shana Rishona, Parashat Shmini, expand on that, that one of the reasons that we require to wash our hands prior to eating bread, it's because they expand the rabbinic decree on Netilat Yadayim Letruma. We're going to study Mitzvah Shem more on that on page 106. Rabbi Shimon Omer, Rabbi Shimon says, even though they're not yet been susceptible to receive a ritual impurity by the blood, hukhsheru bishchita, they have become susceptible to ritual impurity through the act of slaughtering. Because the moment you allow the shchita pass through and made it ready, so it's motzi'a mi'isu, it take away the prohibition of ever minachayel, meaning eating a part of living animal, because that's basically considering an ochel when it's come to a ritual impurity. So one should not eat those meat with yadayim mesoavot, because yadayim metam'ot et habasar, the hands can potentially make the meat ritually impure. So what you have here, you have the implication of the Mishnah. Tama, the Gemara said, de lo yatza mehem dam. The reason the Mishnah said that meat to be eaten unclean hands is because the blood did not come out of those situation of those slaughter animal. Hayatza mehem dam. If it's a regular case that the blood came out of that meat, so we have this meat susceptible to ritual impurity, and therefore ein ne'echalim b'yadayim mesuavot, they cannot be eaten with unclean hands. So because that make the item, the meat, ritually impure. Amai, why? Yadayim shniyot. We say that unclean hands are considering the second degree, the second degree of Tum'ah, as we explained earlier, that's part of the stages, that's the one who is the recipient of the Rishon, ve'ein sheni oseh shlishi bechulin. When it's come to dargot ha-tum'ah, the ritual impurity, so when it's something that is unconsecrated, the second decree, which is this, the sheni le-tum'ah, the second decree of ritual impurity, is not carry on contamination to make it the third one. Sheni cannot create a shlishi, the third one, in the case of not consecrated animal. So the question is, why the meat is susceptible to ritual impurity by Yadai? The Gemara asks, Umimai, what's the basis that we conclude that we're dealing with not the Bechulina Skina, the Mishnah, dealing with non-consecrated item? Maybe the Mishnah speaks about something that is kodashim, that it's consecrated item, that carry a tum'at yadayim, ritual impurity of hand. Therefore, it's correct to say that if it's hukshar, you cannot eat it with unclean hand. So the Gemara said dekatane, because the Mishnah mentioned chaya, which is the among the least of those animals. So they said the ilu kodashim chaya bekodashim miika. If you talk about a sacrificial animals, some animals that consecrated, right? So do we have domesticated animal? We have in kodashim the whole idea of kodashim. Only bakar vatzon, not chayot. Mefarshim expand on that. The only animals that qualified as an offering based on Leviticus chapter 1, verse 2, are cattle, sheep, and goats, which are in the category of behima. You see more on that, we study in Zvachim, page 34. The two, and furthermore, I bekodashim, if you tell me that the Mishnah is dealing with consecrated sacrificial animal, ki lo yatza mehem dam ksheira, if blood will not come out of them, is that befitting, is that kosher? Permissible for consumption? Hu atzmo ledamu tzarich. The whole purpose of shchitat kodashim, slaughtering a consecrated sacrificial offering, in order to pull out the blood and sprinkle on the altar. That's part of the kapara, of the atonements. That's basically heiter, korban la'achila, they allow this offering to be eaten, is by act of sprinkling, not by act of the shchita. So there have to be a Mishnah dealing with shchitat chulin, slaughtering of non-sacrificial, non-consecrated animal that not requested zrikat hadam, the sprinkling of the blood. The third proof that the Mishnah dealing with chulin, so there it's the two, and moreover, if you tell me the Mishnah is dealing with consecrated sacrificial offering, ki yatza mehem dan mimachshir, if the blood will come out of them, will it make the meat susceptible to ritual impurity, as the Mishnah imply? Ve'amar Rabbi Chiya bar Abba, amar Rabbi Yochanan, minayin ledam kodashim she'eno machshir, from where do you know that the blood of consecrated sacrificial offering does not generate susceptibility to ritual impurity? Because the Pasuk tells us in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 12, verse 24, לא תאכלנו, שנאמר לא תאכלנו, על הארץ תשפכנו כמים. Said you shall not eat it, you shall spill it upon the ground like water, which means dam shenishpach kamayim, as we said, one of the seven categories, right? Dam, yad shachat dam, dam blood, shenishpach kamayim machshir. In that sense, blood that may be spilled upon the ground like water generates susceptibility to ritual impurity as water does. Versus she'eino nishpach kamayim, eino machshir. The other way around is not, does not generate susceptibility to ritual impurity. Now, you have this animal and the blood spilled from the neck of the slaughter offering, so may not be allowed to spill upon the ground and go to waste. They have to receive in a sacred vessel and thrown upon the altar. So this, that type of blood is not analogous to water, and therefore does not generate susceptibility to ritual impurity. Now, because we have here now Mishnah that said indirectly that if the blood will come out of the slaughter animal, it will make them susceptible to ritual impurity, we understand that we not discuss here kodashim, a consecrated animal, the fourth. And the final proof that Mishnah is not discussing a kodashim, a consecrated offering. V'tu, and furthermore, I bekodashim, if the Mishnah is referring to consecrated offering, ki lo yatza mehem dam lo mitkashre, litkashre bechibat hakodesh. So they'll be susceptible to ritual impurity by esteem of kodesh, that special ma'ala. The kaimelan chibat hakodesh, because we learn, we establish that esteem for kodesh makes it susceptible to ritual impurity. Chibat hakodesh mechashartan. Amar Rav Nachman amar Rabba baravua, hacha in our Mishnah bechulin shel kachan bekesef maaser askin. And here is a special case that the non-consecrated offering was purchased with money exchange for the second tithe. So here we have the view of the Tana in our Mishnah that the non-consecrated animal of this type can become ritual impurity to contact with unclean hands. Udelo ki Rabbi Meir detnan. Now we're going unlike the view of Rabbi Meir, but the view of the Chachamim, of the sages that disputed him. And that's a well-known Mishnah in Tractate Para, chapter 11, Mishnah 5. Page 33b. Kol ha-ta'un bi'at mayim midivrei sofrim metame et ha-kodesh. We have Torah requirement for ducking once in a mikveh, in a ritual bath, in order to purify that entity. And there is a exemption, theoretically, from the Torah, yet rabbinic enactment that require immersion in the mikveh, in the ritual bath. So they said here, anything that it's a tvila b'mikveh, is immersion in the water of the mikveh, it's by the rabbinic law, which means that if you go by the Torah, is ritually pure, but it's not pure by the rabbinic law. For example, as we mentioned earlier, netilat yadayim, the washing the hand, is rabbinic enactment based on what we mentioned earlier, the story of King Solomon and more. It's a rabbinic requirement. Or if you go by what the Gemara, the Talmud tells us in Tractate Shabbat, page 13b, that it was 18 items that they decree that day. So all this list, metame et hakodesh, contaminates kodesh if they contacted, which means they have a chance to transmit ritual impurity, and that Kodesh turned to be Shlishi, turned to be the third one, and it can continue to transmit ritual impurity to another Kodesh and make it Revi'i, the fourth one, Ufosel et ha-truma, and invalidated the truma for any type of consumption through contact. So truma, the touch it, it's called psula, it's not called tme'a, but because we don't have the concept of revi'i betuma. Umotar bechulin uvema'aser sheni. So it's allowed, permissible, when it's come to ritual, something that is not consecrated, and the second tide, which is we have touch chulin and ma'aser sheni at any type of item, and to eat them right afterward, but and they not carry contamination by touching it. This is the view of Divrei Rabbi Meir. V'chachamim osrim b'ma'aser, the requirement of the second tithe caused the sages to make it ritually impure. So it means, according to them, that stam yadaim, regular shniyot, make ma'aser sheni pasul, and carries that to be shlishi. So if we understand correctly the Mishnah in Para, according to Rabbi Meir, we do not have an issue to eat with hands that it's not pure ma'aser sheni. The Gemara rejected that notion and said, Matkif la Rav Shimi bar Ashi, Mimai, how do you know that the sages hold that second sheni make shlishi when it's come to a second tithe? Dilma, you may say Dilma. Tosfot comment and say that the way that he said in the Mishnah is the correct one, but anyway, they said, Ad kan lo pligi rabbanan leide Rabbi Meir, ela ba'achilat ma'aser. The disputation between the sages and Rabbi Meir is only in regards to eating the second tithe, that Rabbi Meir allow if the hand is shniyot to eat second tithe versus the sages that prohibited it, versus aval bingi ademaser v'achila dechulin lo pligei. However, when it's come to touching second tithe and eating non-consecrated item, the sages do not dispute Rabbi Meir, which is they agree that the hands are shniyot and does not contaminate ma'aser by any form of touching. So therefore, they allow to eat chulin. So the Gemara asks, v'han negi'a hi midiktane ne'echalin biyadayim meso'avot. But the idea of the Mishnah, the way the Mishnah holds that the food is by touching it, touching the food with hands that are not clean. And basically what you understand indirectly, the way that it's alluded, that the hand contaminate the food by touching it. So since the Mishnah taught that ne'echalim b'yadayim mesoavot, that may be eaten with unclean hand, milu askina de kasaf elei chavrei, we are not dealing now Mishnah where one who eats is fed by his fellow who has unclean hands. So they everyone agrees that when it's come to shniyot, they can touch with second tithe. The only disputation between Chachamim and Rabbi Meir is in regard to consumption. So therefore, the Gemara returned to the original understanding, and the Mishnah speaks about shchitat chulin, not ma'aser sheni. Now, there is a different avenue to understand how the hand can make the meat contaminated. Ela marav papa, the Mishnah speaks about unconsecrated meat. V'hacha, when we talk about unclean hand, b'yadayim tchilot askinan. We are dealing in the Mishnah with a hand that have the rishonot, which is the unclean hand, which is rishonot letuma de rabbanan, and that's tam yadayim shniyot. And Rav Papa hold, v'Rabbi Shimon ben Elazar hi, the Tanya. We learn in the Braita that Tosefta Taharot, chapter 1, en yadayim tchilot lechulim. So hands are never considered beginning of ritual impurity and it's come to chulim, unconsecrated items. Even the hand is rishon, is beginning of ritual impurity. They are considered only when it's come to truma and kodesh, but not when it's come to chulim. Rabbi Shimon ben Lazar omer mishum Rabbi Meir, yadayim tchilot lechulim, v'shniyot litruma. So the Gemara asks, wait a second, tchilot lechulim, beginning of tuma in regard to chulim. However, tchilot lechulim ain litruma lo, but cannot be the beginning of tuma. That's basically what Rabbi Shimon Melazar meant when he used the term yadayim tchila. That's chulin and not truma. Truma, by its essence, as a kedusha, is much stringent than chulin when it's come to ritual impurity. Because chulin is a chance for the hands to be tchilot. That make it sheni. So for sure it should be in the truma. Hachi ke'amar, tchilot af lechulin, shniyot letruma en lechulin lo. So the Gemara asks, "Kumi ika yadayim tchilot?" So ever hands that are considered beginning of ritual impurity. So the Gemara brings a Mishnah in Tractate Yadayim, chapter 3. Ditnan, some said, "Tanya hechnis yadav lebeit hamnuga." One person put his hand into the house that carries a tzara'at, which is some form of impurity, some leprosy. So therefore, yadav tchilot, his hands make the beginning of rishonot, of ritual impurity. Divrei Rabbi Akiva. Now Rashi comment that has to be after he washed the hands and he purified them from stam yadayim. V'chachamim omrim yadav shniyot, said that his hand is a second, because according to Chachamim is no such a thing yadav tchilot anytime, and that's the Rambam Hilchot Avodah Tumah chapter 8 said that that's the halacha. Dechule alma, both Rabbi Akiva and the sages, bi'a b'miktzat, lo shma bi'a. That both Rabbi Akiva and the sages agreed that partial entry is not considered, is just putting the hand, is not considered entry. So since the person not enter the house, it's an eternity, his body does not acquire the ritual impurity, only his hand which enter a tameh. That's the Torah tells us in Vayikra chapter 14, verse 46. V'haba el habayit itma'a da'arev. So the tum'ah mid'rabanan is tum'at yadayim. That's decree mishum anichnas bechol gufo lebayit. It's like someone who enter entirely the house that carry leprosy. V'hacha b'gzeira yadav atu gufo kamif ligei. Here we're dealing with the enactment, which is the decree imposing tuma upon the hands on account of his entire body, that Rabbi Akiva and the sages disagree. Mar savar Rabbi Akiva hold yadav kegufo shavhinu rabbanan. Rabbi Akiva hold that the sages make his hands which in turn afflicted house like his entire body. So therefore, by Toralo it's Rishon. Umar Savar and the sages, when they put the decree of ritual impurity, Yadaim ke Yadaim de Alma Shavinu Rabbanan. They hold it as a like ordinary unclean hands upon which Tumah was imposed by rabbinic decree. And ordinary unclean hands are second degree. They're considering Shniyot. Tosfot in Tractate Shabbat, page 14, expand on this. But there is a responsa called Lehorot Natan. The late Rav Gestetner, which I have the privilege to know, in Orach Chaim Siman Aleph, Chelek Zayin, he asked, based on our Gemara, how you treated Eich Hadini Moshit Yado LeBeit HaKnesset or LeBeit HaMerchatz כדי להוציא משם כלי וכדומה ולא נכנס בכל גופו מסך איתו לדב. Someone have in the place that it's not pure, for example, the Beit HaMerchatz, right? Things like that. He need to pull out vessel, utensil. So he bring the Rambam, פרק א' תומעת מת על החי יהוד א', and he quote, the Rambam said, אחד הבא כולו לא אוהל המת, או הבא מקצתו, הרי זה נטמע באוהל. If someone enter the house that they have a corpse, regardless the size, the amount, אפילו הכניס ידו רשץ באותיו יחותמו לא אוהל המת, הרי זה נטמע כולו. So he derived from our סוגיה. דחייבן דרוח רעה שורה בכל בית הכיסא. לכן המושיט ידו לתוכו צריך ליטול ידיו כאילו נכנס כולו. זה לבית הכנסת? אוקיי, לבית הכיסא. דומין אדם מושיט ידו לא אוהל המת נטמע. And then he bring the Rambam, big חידוש, in פרק ט"ז תומת צרת, הלכה ח', וכן העומד בחוץ ופשט ידו לבית מנוגה, נטמעו ידיו בלבד. So basically, הכסף משנה הולד, the Rambam hold the same, this חכמים, מסתנקמה. So it's a big חידוש here on the Rambam. אבדל הרבונון סביר על ידי נטבעות מתאמים רק ששאו בגדי אכילת פרס, מכל מקום, ידיו נטמעו מיד. So the key is that we have to differentiate between טומאת מת באוהל לטומאת בית המנוגה. If it's נטמע ידו, נטמע גופו. So the whole idea is only the רבונון. Versus טומאת מת is the אורייתא. Anyway, do not have time. Okay. ולא כמה כי רבי עקיבא, דאמר ידיו תחילות הוויין, דילמה כי כמה רבי עקיבא הנמילה בתרומה וקודשים דחמירי, אבל לחולין שניות הוויין. So the Gemara said, ולהוויין נמי שניות, דאשמינן לרבי עקיבא דאמר שני עושה שלישי בחולין. דתנן, that's Mishnah in Sota 27b. בו ביום, the day that רבי אלעזר בן עזריה appointed as נשיא, דרש רבי עקיבא, when it's come to ritual impurity of earthware and a creeping animal, the Torah said in Leviticus chapter 11, verse 33, וכל כלי חרס, יטמא, טמא, לא נאמר אלא יטמא, לטמא אחרים, לימד על כיכר שני שהוא עושה שלישי בחולין. הוא עושה דילמה הנמילי בתומא דאורייתא. אבל בדרבנן לא. רבי אלעזר אמר רבי הושעיה, הכה בחולין שנעשו על טהרת הקודש עסקינן. הוא דלא כרבי יהושע. דתנן ודתניא, משנה עם טהרות, chapter 2. רבי אלעזר אומר, האוכל אוכל ראשון ראשון, שני שני, שלישי שלישי. רבי יהושע אומר, האוכל אוכל ראשון ושני, שני שלישי, שני לקודש ואין שני לתרומה. So the Rabbi Yeshua concluded, when is the שלישי לטומאה? בחולין שנעשו על טהרת טומאה. על טהרת טומאה אם, על טהרת הקודש לא, כסבר חולין שנעשו על טהרת הקודש, לית בהו שלישי. So the Gemara ask ולוקמה, so Rabbi Lazar should hold the Mishnah dealing with what? Page 34, בחולין שנעשו על טהרת תרומה ורבי יהושע. זאת אומרת, לא סרקא דאתר דקתני בבשר. דאי בתרומה בשר מאיקה, אלא מאי בקודשים, חיה בקודשים מאיקה, so the Gemara divided and said בשר בבשר מחלף, בשר בפירי לא מחלף.